Presidential daughter Sara Duterte Carpio running for vice president in the 2022 national elections. The younger Duterte has also been adopted as the vice presidential bet of Partido Federal ng Pilipinas, the political party of presidential aspirant Bongbong Marcos Jr. A Duterte to Duterte face-off also possible in next year's polls. Presidential Communications Operations Office Secretary Martin Andanar says President Duterte will file his certificate of candidacy for vice president on Monday. This comes as presidential aspirant Ronald Bato de la Rosa backs out of the presidential derby. And the Metro Manila Council approves the conduct of contact sports, but the events will only be available for both players and spectators who are fully vaccinated. Good afternoon, I'm Stanley Palizada. You're watching Top Story. Davao City Mayor Sara Duterte Carpio ends days of speculations on her 2022 political plans as she filed her certificate of candidacy for vice president today. This comes ahead of the November 15 deadline for substitution. The president's daughter, who previously said she had no intention of running for national office, will now be the VP bet of Lakas CND, headed by former President Gloria Macapagal Arroyo. On Thursday, Duterte Carpio took her oath as member of Lakas. The Davao City Mayor replaced Lakas CMD Vice Presidential nominee Lily Uy. The COC of Duterte Carpio was filed today by attorney Reynold Munsayak. She will be running against Senate President Tito Soto, Senator Kiko Pangilinan, former Congressman Walden Bello, and Dr. Willie Ong. In the meantime, presidential bet Bongbong Marcos Jr. says his party will adopt Duterte Carpio as the vice presidential bet of his party, Partido Federal ng Pilipinas. A political analyst sees a tough road for Sara Duterte Carpio, who is seeking the vice presidency. Tony Lavinia, former dean of the Ateneo School of Government, believes Senate President Tito Soto is still the man to beat for the second highest post in the land, following his strong showing in recent surveys. Lavinia admits while the Davao City Mayor may have an advantage because of the Duterte brand, running a national campaign won't be easy.
Running for vice president for anyone now is a tall order given the strength of Tito Soto. Because Tito Soto is a strong, very strong candidate. And it's going to be hard to defeat him by any other candidate.
Lavinia also says former President Gloria Arroyo could be one of the big winners in next year's polls.
She was able to convince Sara to run. I mean, and she's the mentor of Mayor Sara. So you know, you should never underestimate President Arroyo. She's very smart. She's very strategic. She certainly doesn't want to retreat from governance. She'll be Speaker of the House, looks like, regardless of who wins. Machineries do not matter in the presidential election.
Another big development today, PCOO Secretary Martin Andanar announced to media gathered at the Comelec today that President Duterte will file his certificate of candidacy for vice president on Monday. This is a 180-degree turn for President Duterte, who earlier backed out of the VP race and announced his retirement. In the meantime, Senator Ronald Bato de la Rosa, the presidential aspirant of the ruling party PDP Laban Cusi wing, has backed out of the 2022 presidential race. Bato filed his withdrawal this afternoon, accompanied by President Duterte and longtime aide Bongo. Vice presidential bet Bongo has also withdrawn his candidacy and instead filed his COC as the standard bearer of PDP Laban. One political analyst says the petitions filed against Ferdinand Marcos Jr. may bear repercussions for his presidential bid in next year's elections. Professor Dindo Manhit notes the calls to nullify Marcos's candidacy before the Election Commission might only be the start of other controversies thrown against him and his family. Some groups have filed petitions seeking to either cancel his COC or disqualify him from next year's race due to his 1995 conviction for his failure to file tax returns.
But at the end of the day, it will depend on COMELEC because nasa kamay pa ng COMELEC at maaaring itaas pa to hanggang Supreme Court kung hindi maganda ang resulta. Hindi mo alam kung mayroong bambasihan to, patuloy ba itong i-raise sa iba't ibang korte na proseso ng ating bayan. COMELEC is just the first step.
Let's get a reaction on today's political developments. We are joined by Gene Franco from the Department of Political Science of UP Diliman. Good afternoon, Professor Franco, and thanks for being with us today.
Hi, good afternoon, Stanley.
Yes, Professor Franco, what do you make of Sara Duterte's running for vice president and changing a narrative which she has consistently stuck to in recent days that, of course, she is not running for any national position? I mean, will that kind of ambiguity work in her favor? What do you think?
Well, of course, to her supporters, they must have been energized, no, by her announcement. But for some people, I guess it's it's getting crazier by the day. That's how I hear it from other people. And you know, what is sacrificed here is the there's a saying that your word is you, and I guess word of honor is no longer important nowadays, no?
Okay, did you at least see this coming?
Yeah, of course, yeah. I mean, all the indications are there. All the movements, the press statements, the Facebook posts, social media posts are there. And it's difficult not to believe that Sara will not be running for any national post.
And were you expecting Sara Duterte to run under Lakas CMD? Because she was, in the past year, she was very active in putting up her own party, a regional party, Hugpong, in recent years.
Mm-mm. Well, I expected it when I heard that the former president, Gloria Macapagal Arroyo, was brokering the negotiations.
Okay, a presidential aspirant Bongbong Marcos is saying his party is willing to adopt Mayor Duterte as the ticket's vice presidential candidate. Mm-hmm. What are your insights on such an alliance? I mean, how will it work against or in favor of the other candidates?
It's a strong team. No, it's going to be a strong team, but definitely not unbeatable. Because on the one hand, they have resources, the Marcos money, and whatever you say, Sara is the de facto administration candidate, no?
Mm-hmm.
And then, of course, so they would have ample resources. But the downside is that it's also very easy to criticize, no, their narrative, because they have fathers who are both accused of, having a lot of human rights violations in their administrations.
Okay, based on current trends that you are seeing, how strong a vice presidential candidate is Sara Duterte? I mean, was she right in choosing to be vice president, or should she have run as president?
Well, I don't think it's a matter of being right or wrong. It's really just the fact that...
I mean, was it the correct strategy?
I think so, because she's definitely still young, and she's probably going to be... She wants to run for president someday based on her own merits, having gained experience as vice president. That's probably the case.
Yes, Professor Franco, a recent development, in fact, latest development today. What is your reaction to the announcement of PCO Secretary Martin Andanar that President Duterte is, in fact, planning to file his certificate of candidacy as vice president on Monday, and that would effectively make it a Duterte versus Duterte scenario?
Yeah, no, it's just... unfortunate because this is once again a mockery of our democratic system. People line up just to be able to register to vote. Overseas Filipinos, you know, have to be absent from their jobs just to be able to vote. Filipinos have long fought to be able to vote, no? Especially women. And it's just unfortunate that politicians nowadays do not seem to value that.
Okay, Professor Franco, how big an influence will President Duterte's endorsement of a possible Ferdinand Marcos Sara Duterte tandem, that is of course noting if he does not file a COC on Monday?
It is big because an administration candidate always has an advantage, no, over a non-administration candidate, because technically you have the entire bureaucracy as your supporter, no. But then, on the other hand, in recently Duterte's ratings have gone down, so that might not be too strong an endorsement anymore.
All right. Lastly, on another note, how concerning for Ferdinand Marcos are calls for the nullification of his or the cancellation, in fact, of his COCs, as there are calls for that on the grounds of his failure to file tax returns?
Well, maybe it's just a setback for now, but I'm very sure his camp will fight tooth and nail. No, they've prepared it seems very certain that they've prepared for these elections for quite a long time already, and they will fight tooth and nail to be able to confront that challenge.
Okay, lastly, how will Bongo's candidacy affect the presidential race?
You know, it will affect in the sense that it will be just like a drama once again, no? As we have seen in the run up to November 15. And people will probably just, you know, doubt whether his campaign is really genuine or not, given the turn of events right now.
All right. On that note, thanks a lot, Professor Jean Franco of the Department of Political Science at UP Diliman. Thank you and good afternoon.
Thank you. Thank you.
Moving on, more Philippine personalities are bearing their 2022 election plans 2 days before the deadline for candidate substitution. Labor Secretary Silvestre Bello III is reportedly taking the place of Lakas CMD senatorial candidate Marianito Roque. According to COMELEC documents, Bello has been nominated as the substitute after Roque withdrew his certificate of candidacy earlier today. Meanwhile, former National Task Force to End Local Communist Armed Conflict, or NTF-LCAC spokesman Antonio Parlade Jr. is listed as substitute presidential candidate of Katipunan ng Demokratikong Pilipino Party. That's based on withdrawal documents submitted by KDP's Antonio Valdez. Outgoing Philippine Police Chief Guillermo Eliazar, also reportedly running in 2022. Presidential aspirant Senator Panfilo Lacson says Eliazar will be a part of his and Senator Vicente Soto III's senatorial slate. COMELEC offices will remain open today until 5 p.m. to accommodate what it expects to be a record number of withdrawals and substitutions among aspirants for national positions before Monday's deadline. Poll workers in the 2022 national elections will get a pay bump. The Commission on Elections has granted at least a 2,000 peso increase in their payment and allowances. With a pay increase, the chairperson of the electoral board will get 7,000 pesos, while a medical personnel, which is a new category due to the health crisis, will receive 3,000 pesos. Aside from the honoraria, poll workers will also receive an allowance for travel or communication. An additional 1,000 peso travel allowance on election day will be given to medical personnel, while a communication allowance amounting to 1,500 will be handed to the DESO and the support staff. We'll take a short break. Stay with Top Story. presidential daughter Sara Duterte Carpio running for vice president in the 2022 national elections. The younger Duterte has also been adopted as the vice presidential bet of Partido Federal ng Pilipinas, the political party of presidential aspirant Bongbong Marcos Jr. A Duterte to Duterte face-off also possible in next year's polls. Presidential Communications Operations Office Secretary Martin Andanar says President Duterte will file his certificate of candidacy for vice president on Monday. This comes as presidential aspirant Ronald Bato de la Rosa backs out of the presidential derby. And the Metro Manila Council approves the conduct of contact sports, but the events will only be available for both players and spectators who are fully vaccinated. Welcome back. The Philippines reports nearly 2,000 new COVID-19 cases today. This brings the total to more than 2,815,000. Active cases now at 29,382. 238 people have died, the highest reported since November 5. In the meantime, 1,896 patients have recovered. The Health Department notes all laboratories submitted their data on time. Metro Manila retains its low-risk classification for COVID-19. That's according to the latest report of Octa Research Group. The independent think tank says the National Capital Region logged 427 cases from November 6 to the 12th, which is 5% lower compared with the previous week. For Health Undersecretary Maria Rosario Vergere, the region needs to continue its low-risk classification for COVID-19 so its quarantine restriction can be loosened. Metro Manila is currently under COVID-19 alert level 2.
Low risk ng National Capital Region, for example, kailangan ma-sustain natin ito ng dalawang incubation period. Yung mobility po at saka yung pagsunod sa minimum public health standards at saka yung response ng local governments will matter a lot. Sa pagtaas ng mobility, we anticipate na baka bababa ang atin pong pagko-comply sa minimum public health standards and that will cause an increase in the number of cases.
Going back to our breaking news, we're now joined on the line by PCOO Secretary Martin Andanar on President Duterte's possible vice presidential bid. Good afternoon, Secretary Andanar. Thanks for talking to us.
Hello, Stanley. Magandang hapon sa'yo. Good afternoon to everyone who's watching and listening to your program. Magandang araw po sa lahat ng mga nanonood sa ibang bansa.
All right. Just to officially get that out, sir, can you confirm to us what was earlier reported that President Rodrigo Duterte is filing his certificate of candidacy on Monday for vice president?
That's what the president said earlier when we had a very quick chat that he would go back on Monday. He would file his certificate of candidacy for the vice presidency on Monday. That's what he said. So, I would like to believe that that is the plan for now. But again, this is a developing story. We don't know if this will still be the same plan by tomorrow or by Monday. But the fact remains na Karina, nag-file na po si Senator Bongo for the presidency under the PDDS party, which is a party that is chaired by the father of Greco Melica, who is also running for senator. So the father of Greco did withdraw his candidacy for the presidency. Senator Bongo substituted for him. And Senator Bato, on the other hand, withdrew his candidacy as president under the PDP Laban.
All right, Secretary Andanar, the president mentioned to you when he made that decision.
No, we didn't have the time to talk. I didn't even have the time to ask him questions because there were so many officials around him. And it all happened so quickly. kung tutusin nga, I only found out that the president was going to Comelec at about 3 p.m. today, so I had to rush from my home to Comelec just to be there.
Yes, sir, this situation effectively pits President Duterte against Sara Duterte, also filed for COC for vice president. What are your thoughts on this possibility?
Assuming that Mayor Inday really runs for the vice presidency, and assuming that President Rodrigo Duterte does file for the vice presidency, then that will be the case. But again, we just have to sit back and observe what the next scenarios will be, or what the development will be this coming Monday. Pero Karina, yung po yung sinabi ni Presidente, didn't say that he will come back on Monday, go back to Comelec to file his candidacy.
What's the outlook like for Monday for President Duterte? Is he doing this in the morning, or is there a fixed schedule for this activity already?
I wouldn't know. That's going to be a question for Harry. Okay. Just so happened that Harry wasn't there, so I'm pinch hitting for him. So we'll just wait for Harry's statement, other statements. And when it comes to the president's schedule, see Harry ang merong responsibilidad yan.
Okay. All right. Thanks a lot for talking to us, Secretary Martin Andanar. Thanks for joining us.
It's great to talk to you again, Sandy. Mabuhay ka.
Good afternoon. Moving on, the Metro Manila Council recommends allowing the conduct of organized contact sports, but only for adults and minors who have been fully vaccinated. The resolution signed by Metro Manila mayors today also states that only vaccinated spectators can attend contact sports events.
That in the conduct of a contact sport, the players are prone or susceptible to physical proximity with one another, while the spectators are inclined or given to cheer. Only vaccinated adults and minors shall be allowed to play or watch in an organized or unorganized event.
Players and audience exhibiting symptoms will also be barred from entering the venue. Local governments will also have the option to continue or suspend the events, while organizers of large events must secure permits from LGUs. The Philippine Health Department investigating the cause of COVID-19 infection of a 2-year-old boy who reportedly tested positive days after a trip to the mall. Health Undersecretary Maria Rosario Vergene notes there could be other reasons why the child tested positive for the virus apart from his visit there. Since last week, the national government has allowed minors to go to malls and other establishments in areas under alert level 2.
I don't think it's going to affect our implementation. It's an isolated case. Hindi naman po natin matutukoy with certainty na yun talaga ang naging cause ng pagkakasakit ng bata. Maaring dun lang sa bahay ay doon na siya nahawa. Maaring ang mga nakakatanda niyang kasama sa bahay ay lumalabas at nagtatrabaho. So meron hong mga factors na kailangan nating tignan. Papaalala lang ho tayo sa ating mga magulang na atin pong bigyan ng extra care ang ating mga bata, lalong-lalo na ngayon na marami pong mga tao. Pag nakita ho natin na parang crowded na yung lugar, huwag na po natin isama yung ating mga kabataan.
A group of local chief executives want Malacañang to leave the decision on face shield use to the local government units. The Union of Local Authorities of the Philippines President and Quirino Governor Dakila Cua argues local officials will be in the best position to determine if face shields are still needed in their areas. This comes as some city governments ease their face shield policy amid a drop in COVID-19 cases.
LGU na po ang mag-determine according to their doctors kung kailangan ba mag-face shield in certain circumstances, at sila na rin ang magpatupad.
But while the Interior Department agrees with local officials, they have the authority to loosen restrictions on face shield use. Malacañang is appealing to local governments to wait for President Duterte's final order to confusing the public. Health Undersecretary Maria Rosario Vergere says experts have submitted their recommendation on the face shield policy to the Office of the President. Problems still arise from the issuance of digital vaccination certificates more than 2 months after the launch of the online portal. Zian Ambrosio has more.
Hindi nakakaintindihan itong mga opisyal ng ating gobyerno. Dapat isa lang may desisyon para hindi malito yung taong bayan.
A senior citizen, Leonido Tanyedo, was infuriated while being interviewed at the assistance booth of Vax Cert at the Quezon City Hall. Leonido says he cannot get a Vax Cert or vaccination certificate from the Vax Cert portal. He is problematic and pressured to get it as it is one of the requirements in his province where he is headed to.
Pahirap ito sa mga uuwi ng probinsya.
Aldrin, who already bought a ticket for his trip to Negros province, is worried for his family, since the vax certificate is also a requirement by the LGU and their municipality.
Nahabulo namin yung protocol nila kasi kailangan nila doon.
The official of QC Task Force Vaccination, Dr. Malu Eleria, explains why some people cannot get their vax cert due to minor errors written by the vaccinees in their vaccination form.
Baka may mali sa spelling ng kanilang pangalan o kaya naman yung birthday, nakakapalit po yung birthday.
Caloocan has the same predicament.
Kami sa Caloocan, maraming nangyayari na minsan mali yung spelling or minsan naman mali yung middle initial or middle name and birthday.
But there are cities like Manila which do not have a backlog.
Nagkakaroon kami ng problema with yung data ng mga vaccinees namin po. Right there and then po naman po nako-correct na namin.
Due to incomplete information uploaded by some local government units, the DILG says it will temporarily allow the vaccination cards from the LGUs.
Our advice to local government units at sa lahat ng mga ahensya is tanggapin pa rin nila yung local vaccination card. Okay? Kasi nga, it would be unfair naman doon sa ating mga nagpabakuna sila, ngunit hindi pa na-upload ng kanilang LGU. No? So to address this, Ian, ay nagbigay na po ng kautusan si Secretary Eduardo Anyo na mag-issue ng show-cause order sa mga local government units na naging pabaya sa pag-upload ng kanilang datos.
An estimated 30% of vaccination data has not been uploaded by some LGUs. For those who still do not have their vax cert, simply type vax cert in your web browser. You will be asked about their vaccination status. Click the arrow and choose the phrase fully vaccinated if you are fully vaccinated. The second question that will pop up, just click yes and the OK button. Then press next. You will then be asked about your personal information such as your full name and your birthday. Whatever is written in your vaccination card should be the same as in the portal. Then key in information on the vaccination details such as the city or municipality where you were vaccinated. Below the page, choose Verify Vaccination Information. Validate all the info. A code will come out. Just copy the code and press OK. Your vaccination certificate will appear soon. Zian Ambrosio, ABS-CBN News.
Over 1.2 million doses of Moderna's COVID-19 vaccine procured by the Philippine government arrived in the country Saturday morning. The delivery comes as government gets ready for a three-day national vaccination drive on November 29. Moderna is also one of the vaccines approved for children aged 12 to 17. Latest data show over 30.8 million Filipinos are already fully vaccinated. That's 40% of government's 77 million target by the end of the year. The Philippine Health Department reminds the public not to get COVID-19 booster shots for third doses before the scheduled rollout in the country. Health Undersecretary Maria Rosario Vergere says the Food and Drug Administration still hasn't amended the emergency use authorization of the vaccines to include the additional doses. The Philippines is hoping to start administering booster shots to health workers on Monday, though there are reports many individuals have already received these jabs. COVID-19 jabs now required for Filipinos who have to work on site. The government says the mandate should not be used as basis to fire any unvaccinated employee. Pia Gutierrez with the full story.
Starting December 1, COVID-19 vaccinations will be made mandatory for all on-site workers who are eligible to get inoculated against the virus in areas with sufficient vaccine supplies. The country's anti-COVID task force approved the mandate as part of efforts to boost the country's vaccination numbers. But Malacañang was quick to clarify that non-vaccination against COVID-19 should not be a ground to terminate an employee.
Sa mga eligible employees na hindi bakunado, maaaring hindi sila matanggal sa trabaho dahil lamang sa rason na hindi sila bakunado. Pero kinakailangan nilang mag-undergo ng regular RT-PCR testing or antigen test at their own expense.
The IATF has also required the full vaccination of all eligible workers in public transportation services as a condition to continue their operations.
Isa pang measure ay hindi pagmarka ng absent sa lahat ng workers na mababakunahan sa oras ng trabaho basta magpakita lamang ng proof ng confirmed vaccination schedule.
The Labor Group Trade Union Congress of the Philippines supports the mandatory vaccination of on-site workers.
Looking forward to it. We are looking forward to a vaccination of a greater number of workers to help our economy recover immediately.
But the group says government should focus on boosting vaccine supply instead of punishing the unvaccinated.
Giving workers the incentives to vaccinate, to encourage them rather than to penalize or to coerce or scare them to vaccinate. No, we are also asking the government to provide more access for the workers because they are saying that the country has now sufficient number of vaccines. But when we look at the local government units, the workers, the people do not have the access to these vaccines.
Meanwhile, the IATF is enjoining government agencies and local government units to provide incentives for vaccination, such as giving priority to fully vaccinated individuals in accessing government services and programs. But Roque says this does not apply to frontline and emergency services, which shall continue to render assistance to all persons, regardless of vaccination status. For public and private establishments, they may require proof of vaccination from their customers or patrons and turn away individuals who remain unvaccinated even if they are eligible for vaccination. But for those who are not eligible to get vaccines, Roque says they can only present two documents to prove why they cannot get inoculated against COVID-19, a medical clearance or their birth certificate. Pia Gutierrez, ABS-CBN News.
The Philippine Tourism Department appeals to more local government units to further reduce travel requirements. This as 70% of Filipino tourism workers are already fully vaccinated. Tourism Secretary Bernadette Romulo Puyat also says they are hoping that the country would open up its borders to tourists from green countries soon so that foreign tourism can help boost the country's economy. Overseas, the Netherlands returns to partial lockdown today, Saturday, due to surging COVID-19 cases. The latest restrictions include early closing time for restaurants, shops, and nightclubs. Spectators are also now barred from major sporting events. The partial lockdown will be in place for 3 weeks. The new coronavirus infections in the Netherlands topped a record 16,000 for the second day in a row on Friday. Several countries in Europe are raising new restrictions as the region is again becoming the epicenter of the pandemic. Germany, meanwhile, brings back free COVID-19 tests as part of measures to contain the wave of infections. The free tests, which were first offered from March as a way to offset a slow vaccine rollout, are being reinstated 1 month after they were allowed to run out. The country's acting health minister has also said he supported a stricter requirement that would mean people who are vaccinated or have recovered from COVID-19 must provide a negative coronavirus test to attend public events. Hospitals in Germany are buckling under the strain of rising cases, forcing government to relocate some patients from regions with overburdened facilities. Over in the U.S., a blow to the Biden administration after an appeals court upheld its decision putting on hold President Joe Biden's vaccine mandate on companies. The three-member panel called the mandate staggeringly overbroad. Biden imposed the order in September requiring businesses with at least 100 employees to get their staff vaccinated or face weekly COVID-19 tests. The White House had been hoping to address the vaccine hesitancy and contain rising COVID-19 cases. But U.S. states, private employers, and religious organizations filed legal challenges saying the order violates the Constitution and curbs individual liberty. In other news, Philippine presidential spokesperson Harry Roque fails to secure a seat at the International Law Commission. Of some 190 United Nations member states, only 87 voted in favor of Roque's nomination to the ILC. Roque had the least number of votes among representatives of 11 countries seeking to be part of the Commission's 8-seat Asia-Pacific bloc. The spokesperson acknowledged the defeat and said he wishes the new members of the ILC well. He adds he will continue to push for their advocacy, such as fighting climate change and vaccine inequity. Roque's nomination comes amid strong opposition from human rights groups and fellow lawyers. Days ahead of the vote, more than 150 Philippine lawyers wrote to the UN member states opposing Roque's bid. They cited his previous defense of Duterte's statements on killings, attacks on the rule of law, and his position on the country's poor pandemic response. Several activists also held protests in New York against Roque's bid. We will take a short break. Stay with Top Story. Presidential daughter Sara Duterte Carpio running for vice president in the 2022 national elections. The younger Duterte has also been adopted as the vice presidential bet of Partido Federal ng Pilipinas, the political party of presidential aspirant Bongbong Marcos Jr. A Duterte-Duterte face-off also possible in next year's polls. Presidential Communications Operations Office Secretary Martin Andanar says President Duterte will file his certificate of candidacy for vice president on Monday. This comes as presidential aspirant Ronald Bato de la Rosa backs out of the presidential derby. Also backing out of his VP bid is Senator Bongo, who is now seeking the presidency under the Federalismo ng Dugong Dakilang Samahan, a pro-Duterte group founded by Presidential Anti-Corruption Commission Chairman Greco Belica. And the Metro Manila Council approves the conduct of contact sports, but the events will only be available for both players and spectators who are fully vaccinated. Welcome back. Former Philippine Economic Chief Romulo Neri, sanctioned by the Supreme Court in connection with his role in a controversial broadband deal with a Chinese telco giant 14 years ago. The details from Mike Navallo.
Cleared of criminal graft charges in 2016, Romulo Neri, the former socio-economic planning secretary, is now barred from holding another public office. This comes as the Supreme Court Third Division found him guilty of the administrative charge of grave misconduct for his role in brokering the controversial NBN-ZTE deal in 2007. Neri told the Senate inquiry that then-Comelec Chair Benjamin Abalos offered to bribe him 200 million pesos to approve the proposal from Chinese company Xingxing Telecommunications Equipment, or ZTE, to create a national broadband network linking all government agencies and offices. Abalos was supposedly working on behalf of ZTE, offering a competitor $10 million to withdraw a much lower bid, and when that didn't work, tried to work out a partnership with the help of Neri's technical consultant Jun Lozada, who later became a whistleblower. Neri said former President Gloria Macapagal Arroyo told him to refuse the bribe but to proceed to process the project anyway. The government eventually awarded the $329 million contract to ZTE, but Arroyo dropped the project following the ensuing controversy. The Supreme Court said Neri was guilty of grave misconduct when he dined with Abalos, ZTE, and Chinese embassy officials. Far from an ordinary meeting, the Supreme Court said Neri had the power to approve ZTE's bid. Just by accepting the invitation, he already violated the Code of Conduct for Public Officials and Employees. The court also found it was Neri who introduced Lozada to Abalos in a bid to reconcile the bids of ZTE and its competitor. The Supreme Court also rejected Neri's position that he was merely following Arroyo's instructions. The court said Neri was Director General of NEDA and Vice Chair of its board, not powerless positions to blindly follow orders. Arroyo herself was accused of dining and playing golf with ZTE officials that would spawn graft charges with her husband Mike Arroyo and Abalos at the anti-graft court. Those charges were later dismissed due to insufficient proof that Abalos brokered the deal, that Arroyo was motivated by personal gain, and that the contract was grossly disadvantageous to the Philippine government. And while Abalos and the Arroyos are now cleared of graft charges, Neri faces the consequences of what he described as merely following the president's orders. In 2016, Lozada was convicted for graft by the Sandigan Bayan 4th Division, a corrupt act when he was president and chief executive officer of the state-owned Philippine Forest Corporation in 2007 and 2008. Lozada was charged for unlawfully awarding the lease contract of more than 6 hectares of public land to his brother, Jose Orlando, forgoing the regular application process. Mike Navalio, ABS-CBN News.
2 weeks of UN climate talks in Glasgow blew past a deadline on Friday as nations still try to hammer out a deal to limit global warming. A deal is now expected sometime Saturday, as there remain, though, talking on issues such as the phasing out of fossil fuel subsidies, carbon markets, and financial help for poor countries to tackle climate change. The summit's goal is to limit global temperature rise within the 1.5 degrees Celsius agreed at the 2015 Paris Agreement. But under current national pledges at the COP26, researchers fear the world's temperature could soar far beyond that limit, unleashing catastrophic sea level rises, droughts, storms, and wildfires. Climate campaigners are also not happy with the diluted language used in the draft proposal, asking states to phase out fossil fuel subsidies. It also lacks detail on future payment from rich countries that are primarily responsible for global warming to the poorer countries that are taking the brunt of it. The deal would need a unanimous consent from the nearly 200 nations participating. The anticipation virtual meeting between U.S. President Joe Biden and Chinese President Xi Jinping set on Tuesday, Asia time. That confirmation from Beijing. In the U.S., the meeting falls on Monday night. The two leaders are expected to discuss ways on how to manage bilateral competition and work together where their common interests align. Biden and Xi are expected to cooperate on climate change action following their joint climate declaration and COP26 summit. But analysts expect them to remain at odds over trade and Beijing's increasing military pressure against Taiwan. Asia-Pacific Economic Cooperation APEC leaders vow to address economic recovery in the region by shoring up supply chains, tackling labor issues, and continuing to respond to the pandemic. In a joint statement following a series of virtual meetings, the 21-member group also pledged to work together to address climate and environmental challenges. The APEC summit is the last multilateral meeting of the year, ending a flurry of high-profile gatherings, including the COP26 in Glasgow and the G20 summit in Rome. President Rodrigo Duterte also calling for the increased international cooperation at the APEC meeting to speed up the region's recovery from the COVID-19 pandemic. Duterte also urged the creation of an integrated system on vaccine passport validation and contact tracing, as well as the institutionalization of social protection for non-traditional forms of employment. He also called for the promotion of transnational education and digital inclusion in APEC economies. With the prevailing climate emergency, the president also reiterated his call for developed countries to fulfill climate financing commitments to vulnerable developing nations. Moving on to the migrant crisis unfolding in Europe, Belarus says it has sent some 2,000 migrants back to their countries as part of efforts to stop illegal migration. Its foreign minister said, in addition to those sent away, around 700 violators were also detained at the border. The European Union is accusing Belarus of encouraging migrants to illegally cross into Poland and Lithuania through its borders, a claim Belarus denies. The EU also says Turkish Airlines, one of the main international carriers flying to Minsk, has agreed to suspend one-way ticket sales for Middle Eastern migrants seeking to reach Europe via Belarus. Thousands of migrants from the Middle East are currently sheltering in freezing conditions in the woods on the border. Some have died, and the U.S. is expressing great concern over the situation in Belarus.
I think it's of great concern. We've communicated our concern to Russia. We've communicated our concern to Belarus. We think it's a problem.
Former U.S. President Donald Trump advisors Steve Bannon charged for defying a subpoena issued by House lawmakers investigating the January 6th Capitol riot. He could face up to 1 year in jail and a maximum fine of $100,000. Bannon had refused to give testimonies and documents related to the attack, citing his right to keep the requested materials confidential, a notion which has already been rejected. This is the second time the advisor has faced criminal charges in 15 months. He was arrested in August 2020 for defrauding donors for Trump's wall project along the U.S.-Mexican border. Bannon is expected to surrender on Monday and make his first court appearance on the Capitol Hill case. Healthcare giant Johnson & Johnson announces plans to spin off its consumer products business from its pharmaceuticals and medical device operations. The details in this report.
Johnson & Johnson plans to split in two, the largest shakeup in the firm's 135-year history. J&J said Friday it will spin off its consumer health division, maker of Band-Aids and baby powder, from its pharmaceuticals and medical devices business. And it echoes moves by other storied conglomerates, Toshiba and General Electric, to voluntarily divide themselves into smaller and seemingly simpler operations. Others in the healthcare space have done likewise, as the slow and steady business of selling consumer products such as moisturizer and shampoo is increasingly different from the high-risk, high-reward work of developing and marketing medicine. J&J said it will separate its consumer business into a new publicly traded company, something rivals GlaxoSmithKline and Pfizer plan to do with their joint consumer health business next year. J&J's Joaquin Duato, who is expected to become the firm's CEO in January, said in a statement, quote, "The new Johnson & Johnson and the new consumer health company would each be able to more effectively allocate resources to deliver for patients and consumers, drive growth, and unlock significant value." Johnson & Johnson will retain its pharmaceuticals and medical device units, which sells its COVID-19 vaccine, drugs such as cancer treatment Darzalex, and medical devices. The units are expected to generate revenue of roughly $77 billion in 2021. The company is aiming to complete the planned separation in 18 to 24 months.
India's capital, New Delhi, covered by thick smog once again. The toxic haze blanketing the city was triggered by a drop in temperature, as well as the burning of crop waste in surrounding farmlands. The capital's air quality index reached over 400, which means the polluted air can affect healthy people and adversely impact those with existing diseases. Filipino pool player Carlo Biado victorious in Abu Dhabi. The reigning U.S. Open champ outclassed fellow Filipino Jordan Banares 13-6 in the finals of the 9-Ball Open Championship. Biado was undefeated in the whole tournament, beating other compatriots in the round of 16, quarters, and semifinals. In entertainment, 90 more lawsuits are filed against the promoters of the deadly Astroworld Festival stampede in Houston. That's on top of the 50 other lawsuits already brought against Live Nation Entertainment and rapper Travis Scott over last week's concert. Lawyers argued organizers could have prevented injuries and fatalities by stopping the show and turning on to house lights when chaos became apparent. 9 people aged 14 to 27 died in the event. The latest fatality is a 22-year-old college student who passed away Wednesday, while a 9-year-old boy remains in critical condition. Free Britney has now become more than just a mantra. That's after a Los Angeles judge ended the conservatorship that has ruled the life of pop star Britney Spears for 13 years. Spears celebrated her regained freedom on social media, calling it the best day ever. She also expressed love for her fans who gathered outside the courthouse waving pink signs of support. The conservatorship was set up and overseen by the singer's father after Britney had a public breakdown in 2007 and was hospitalized for undisclosed mental health issues. And before we go, Christmas is in the air in Los Angeles as the city's Arboretum is lit up with a mile-long light show, the Arcadia, located at the LA County Arboretum and Botanic Garden, starts to glow after sunset. Thanks to these illuminated installations, the show has been a sellout across the UK and has massively expanded across the US in recent years. It features impressive lighting designs complemented with musical numbers to bring holiday cheer. And those were the top stories today. I'm Stanley Palisade. You can watch exclusive content and highlights and recaps of our shows online. Thanks for watching.
The greatest disruptor of all time is actually COVID-19. Because of limited mobility, people are also not being able to go to physical branches, etc. So it further accelerated the adoption of consumers of digital channels.